Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to explain the analysis and the design of the gantry girder. So before going into the analysis and the design of the gantry girder, so first I'm going to discuss about the basics of the gantry girder. So first we'll look into the definition of the gantry girder. So now the gantry girders are the girders which supports the load transmitted through the traveling wheels of the crane, which is as shown in figure. So usually if we go for any industrial manufacturing unit, there overhead traveling cranes are required to carry the equipment or any materials from one place to the another place. So for that reason, the hand operated or electrically operated cranes that will be used. So these cranes that are attached to the a crane girder or a bridge, and that particular crane that has the ability to move in the that particular crane has a facility to move in this particular direction in the this I will take it as a lateral direction in the lateral direction of the industrial building. I suppose if the crane has to move in the longitudinal direction, then at the end of this crane girder, so wheels will be provided. Okay, and those wheels are traced over the rails which are attached over this particular beam or a girder. This complete whole bridge moves longitudinally, that means in this direction, longitudinally on the rails provided at the ends. And these rails are rested over a beam. That particular beam is called as gantry girder. So I have a few images to show the actual view of the gantry girder or an industrial setup. See here you can see that the yellow colored girder, this is the a crane girder, and this crane girder is resting on the rails which are provided over this particular girder and which facilitates the movement of the crane girder over it. So this girder is called as gantry girder. Similarly, a few more images are there which shows the crane girder and the gantry girder. So here yellow colored one is the crane girder and the blue colored one is the gantry. So that means the girder or we can call it as a bridge also, this one which carries the crane which lifts the any equipment or any materials to transfer from one place to the another place, that girder we'll call it as a crane girder. And the gantry girder is the one which facilitates the movement of the crane girder along the longitudinal direction of the building. So that is called as gantry girder. So here also you can see the both the crane and the gantry girder. So here also yellow colored one is the crane girder, and this red colored one, that's the gantry girder. So then we'll look into the typical cross sections which we are supposed to use for the gantry girder. So here we'll see about the typical cross sections which normally we can use for the gantry girder. So usually the selection of the suitable cross section for the gantry girder, that depends on two criteria. One is the span of the girder, and the other one is capacity of the crane. Okay, so these are the two important criteria which controls the selection of the suitable section for the gantry girder. So we'll see one by one. First, when we need to go for the simple eye girder. So we need to go for the simple eye girder or rolled beams with or without plates at the anywhere top or bottom. So that is suitable for the span up to 8 meter, and the crane capacity is usually 50 kilonewton. So we can use the eye sections with or without plates. That is, this is a simple eye section. This is the eye section with the channel at the top, and this is the eye section with the angles which are placed, which are attached to the top flange of the eye section. So these three type of the section that are preferred when the span is up to 8 meter and the capacity of the crane is 50 kilonewton. Then if the span is from 6 to 10 meter, then we need to go for the plate girder. See, the reason why we need to go for the plate girder, because so when we do the calculation, that means when we do the analysis, so we will get to know what is the depth required to resist the load. That is, what is the depth required for an eye section to resist the load. We all know that we have a limitation of a depth in the rolled beams, so we cannot get a rolled beams for whatever the depth is we required. Okay, so the maximum depth available for a rolled beam is 600 mm. If the depth required is beyond 600 mm, then we have to go for the plate girders. So here the plate girders are a type of girders where the eye sections has been made by connecting the beams. That means by placing the one beam vertically and two beam horizontally like this, and by welding or by connecting these three plates together, and that forms the eye shape. So this kind of girders we call it as a plate girder. So wherever we have a limitation, wherever the depth required is more than 600 mm, then we need to go for the plate girders. Those plate girders are preferred with the channels. Those plate girders are preferred when the span is 6 to 10 meter, and the other case, a plate girder with the channels or angles, etc. So as a top flange, so that is for the span more than 10 meter. If the span is more than 10 meter while creating a plate girder, so what we can do is, so just take a plate girder for a web portion and for the bottom flange again plate. As a top flange, instead of taking a simple plate, we can consider the, we can take the channel section. So this kind of sections also that can be made as a plate girder, that will be used, or that is preferred for the span which is more than 10 meter. Then the next one is a box girder with the angle for the span more than 12 meter. So if the span is more than 12 meter, then we need to go for the box girder. Which is made out of angles. Here we can make the box shaped girders by placing the angles at the corners like this. Okay, and these are connected by the plate. And these are connected by the plate. So this forms the box girder. So these kind of girders are preferred when the span is more than 12 meters. Then we need to go for the crane truss, using I section as a chord members and angle as a web members. So these are the typical sections which we can normally use for the gantry girder. Then next we'll look into the suitable type of the gables which we are supposed to provide to rest the gantry girder. Here we know that these gantry girders are placed over the columns, or we need to make some arrangement by providing the gables to place the gantry girder. Here if the capacity of the crane is less, then we can provide a haunch or a gable for the existing column. So for that, over that we can place the gantry girder. So this kind of arrangement we can use when the capacity of the crane, when the capacity of the crane is about 10 tons. If it is about 50 tons, then what we can do is, here you need to increase the section of the column till the gantry girder, and over that we can go for the lesser dimension sections. So this can, these kind of column arrangements, it can be made for the gantry girders which provides the support for the crane whose capacity is 50 tons. Similarly, when you have the heavy cranes, then we need to go for the separate columns, and then those columns that can be connected to the main column either through the battens or through the lacings. So here in the previous figures where I had shown the gantry girder, we'll look those figures we look into those figures, like what kind of arrangements they had made. So if you see this particular column here, like they had made a separate column itself to carry the crane girder, because this capacity might be more, so they have used this kind of arrangement. Then in the next figure, if you see, if you just look into this figure, you can guess that the crane girder what you have, it's of a less capacity, and then here the cable itself that has been made for a column, so over that the gantry girder is placed directly. And here also, because of the crane girder has a more capacity, they had opted the separate columns to carry the gantry girders. So it's like depending on the capacity of the crane and depending on the span, we need to choose the suitable type of the sections for the gantry girder and also for the crane girder. Then again, depending on the same parameters, that is the capacity of the crane and then the span, we need to choose a suitable arrangement to place the gantry girder over the columns. Then moving on, so after knowing about the what are the typical sections which we are supposed to use for the gantry girder and for the typical arrangements of the columns to keep the gantry girder, the next we'll look into the loads which we are supposed to consider for the analysis of the gantry girder. So here in the discussion I explained that the gantry girders are made to provide the path for the movement of the crane girder along the a longitudinal direction of the building to transfer the material or any equipment from one point to the another point within the building itself. So in that case, if you see, so since the gantry girder has to take the load from the crane girder, the first thing it will get a vertical load from the crane, then it also get the impact load from the crane. So how it will get the impact load from the crane? We know that the impact load is any type of a load which acts over a very short interval of a time. So usually when the crane girder moving over the gantry girder along the longitudinal direction, so when this crane girder, when it needs to stop at certain point, okay, so when it needs to stop at certain point, then it needs to be applied a brake. So when you apply a brake, then it provides a jerk. So because of that process, the impact load will get acted over a gantry girder from the crane. So that's how the impact load will get. Here the magnitude of the impact load, that will be some percentage of the vertical load what will get from the crane. Then it also get a longitudinal horizontal force along the rail and then lateral thrust across the rail. So now we'll see what has to be the impact allowance for in different direction and different type for different types of the crane. So first we'll see for the vertical loads. If it is a electrically operated crane, then it needs to be 25% of the maximum static wheel loads. And then if it is a AND operated crane, then it must be a 10% of the maximum static wheel loads. Similarly for the horizontal forces, if it is electrically operated crane, then we need to take 10% of weight of the trolley and the weight lifted on the crane. Then if it is a hand operated, then we need to take 5% of weight of the trolley and weight lifted on the crane. Then the horizontal force along the rail, that is equal to, so now that the if this is a rail, so it gets a horizontal force due to the lateral movement of the wheels. So this is how the wheels will be placed. Okay, so due to the lateral movement of the wheels, so that exerts the horizontal force over the rail. So that is equals to 5% of the static wheel loads. So then here we'll see the critical loading conditions. So here you know that this is the wheels of the crane girder. So totally the crane girder as a four contact points over the gantry girder. So when you see in the plan, see this is the one gantry girder and this is the gantry girder which is on the other side, and normally we will be having this is the crane girder. So the crane girder will have the four contact points over the gantry girder, and this girder as a crane. It will be having a crane, and this crane girder, it can move in this direction, and the complete assembly that can move in the longitudinal direction. So now to analyze the gantry girder for the critical condition, so while finding the shear force, you know that the shear force will be maximum at the supports, then so these two wheels has to be placed close to the support. Then whatever the reaction force you will get at the support for which the wheel has been placed closer, so that a support reaction will be taken as the maximum shear force. So here the free body diagram has been given. So this is how it needs to be placed, and throughout the session we will use, will represent C as the spacing between wheels. Okay. So when you have this kind of arrangement, we'll get the maximum shear force. Then to get the maximum bending moment, so you have to keep a one wheel at a distance of C by 4. You know that C is a spacing between the two wheels of the crane girder. So when you keep any one wheel at a distance of C by 4 from the midpoint of the gantry girder. So this kind of wheel arrangement that gives the maximum bending moment. So in order to find the maximum bending moment, we need to keep any one wheel at a distance of C by 4, where C is the gap between the wheels of the crane girder, at a distance of C by 4 from the center of the gantry girder. From the center of the gantry girder, then the bending moment below this load, the bending moment below the this particular wheel load, that is the maximum bending moment that the gantry girder can get. So this is the critical loading conditions which we are supposed to use to determine the magnitude of maximum shear force and then maximum bending moment. So then here there are specifications which it needs to be followed while doing the design of the gantry girder. So this particular table, we have a deflection limit which we are supposed to check after selecting the section for the gantry girder. Like whatever the section we choose for the load, what it is getting, its vertical deflection, it should not be greater than these criteria. We'll see the criteria one by one. So first, if it is a manually operated crane, okay, so if it is a manually operated crane, then the maximum deflection should not be more than L by 500, where L is the span of the gantry girder. And similarly, if it is a electrically operated cranes with capacity less than 500 kilonewton, then the limit is L by 750. Then if it is a crane with capacity greater than 500 kilonewton, then the deflection limit is L by 1000. So for the lateral deflection, the relative between the rails, it should not be more than 10 mm or L by 400, whichever is least. So this is the criteria which we supposed to check when we do the check for the deflection. So the deflection, it should not be more than these limiting values. For the manually operated crane, it is L by 500. For electrically operated crane with capacity less than 500 kilonewton, so that is L by 750. Electrically operated crane with capacity greater than 500 kilonewton, that is L by 1000. And when it comes to the lateral deflection, which is relative between the rails, so the lateral deflection, it should not be more than 10 mm or L by 400. So then whichever is least. So that is the specification we need to check. So till now we discussed about the some basic concepts about the gantry girder, and then what are the typical sections which we are supposed to use for the gantry girder depending on its span and the capacity of the crane, and again depending on the same parameters, how the column arrangements for keeping the gantry girder that has to be made. Then we discuss about the loads which we are supposed to consider for the analysis of the gantry girder, and then what has to be the impact allowance in different direction, that is in the vertical direction as well as in the horizontal direction. So then we saw the then we discussed about the what has to be the critical loading conditions. That means in order to find the a maximum shear force and the maximum bending moment, how the loads has to be placed, and then the deflection limit. So after the discussion, like after knowing all these things, then we'll move on to the analysis and the design of the gantry girder. So here we need to design a simply supported gantry girder to carry an electrically operated crane with the following data. So the span of the crane bridge, that is the span of the crane bridge is 25 meters. It is 25 meters. The span of the crane bridge 25 meters, and then the column spacing. So what we know that the gantry girders are placed over the column. So whatever the column spacing is given, so that itself needs to be considered as the span of the gantry girder. So that is equal to 8 meters. Then the wheel base is 3.5. So wheel base is nothing but this is equal to C. So we know that C is a distance between the wheels of the crane girder. So that called as a wheel base. So here this is, can be represented as C, and then the crane has a capacity, that is a lifting capacity of a 200 kilonewton, and then weight of the crane bridge or the crane girder, the total weight of the crane girder is 150 kilonewton. Then weight of the trolley or a crab, that is 75 kilonewton. Then the minimum hook distance, that is 1 meter. Then the weight of the rail, that is 0.3 kilonewton per meter. And then height of the rail is 105 mm. So these are the data which is given to design the simply supported gantry girder. So first we'll start with the load calculation. So here in order to design the gantry girder, first we are supposed to get the magnitudes of the loads which is getting transferred from the crane girder onto the gantry girder. So in that, whatever the reaction force you will get for the crane girder, so these reaction forces will act as a load onto the gantry girder. So now we know that this crane girder, it will be the crane which is attached to for the lifting of the any instrument, it will be moving in the lateral direction, or lateral direction of the building, or I can say longitudinal direction of the crane girder. Okay, so this load, this is a crane capacity of 200 kilonewton, and 75 is the self weight of the crab. Okay, so this 275 kilonewton what is there, it will be moving throughout the length of the crane girder. And we know that whenever the position of this load changes, so that also differs the reaction force. So now While designing any section, we need to consider the critical loading case. So we will get the maximum reaction force only when this force or this only when the weight of the crane or a location of the crane when it is placed close to the gantry. So here this crane, it cannot move till the support. So here it has a gap. So this gap is called as a minimum hook distance. So in this problem, the minimum hook distance is given as 1 meter. So either on this side or on this side, so this load, it can travel up to this point only. So it will be having a minimum hook distance of 1 meter. Suppose if I place this load here, whatever the reaction force you will get at this support, this is a maximum force which the crane girder can transfer over the gantry girder. Okay, so this is the position of the crane at which we will get the maximum load over the gantry. And this 150 kN is the capacity of the self weight of the crane bridge. So we know that self weight that can be considered at the midpoint. So that is 150 kN. So now if we find the magnitude of Ra, so that is the maximum force that the crane girder can transfer over the gantry girder. So we'll see what is the magnitude of Ra we'll get. So to determine the value of Ra, we need to take the moment about B. So when we take the moment about B, so this is moment about B. So this is the free body diagram what we have. Ra and this is Rb, that is B, and this is A, and here you have a 275 kN, and at center you have 150 kN. So this is 1 meter. And the total span is 25 meter, and this is at the center, so this becomes 12.5 meters. Okay, so now we'll take the moment of all the forces about B. Then the moment produced by Ra about B will be equal to Ra into 25, and it's in the direction of clockwise. So it will be treated as positive, Ra into 25. Then the moment produced by 150 kN, it's in anti-clockwise. So this will be equal to 150 multiplied by 12.5. Then the moment produced by 275 kN, that is also in anti-clockwise direction. So this is minus 275 into 24. So value of Ra is equal to 339 kN. If you work it out, we'll get Ra is equal to 339 kN. So here there are two wheels on each end of the crane bridge. See here, for our to make the calculation simple, even though it has a four contact points of the crane girder or a crane wheel or the gantry girder, so we took only the two points, but this load what we obtained here, it is being transferred at a two different point on each side of the each end of the crane girder. That means from each wheel the load which is being transferred onto the gantry girder, that is equal to Ra by 2. Okay, so since there are 2 wheels at each end of the sandwich, therefore the load on each wheel will be half of 339, that is 169.5, that is 169.5. Then we need to take the factored wheel load. So in order to take the factored wheel load, it needs to be multiplied by 1.5, that is 1.5 multiplied by 169.5, and that is 211.87 kilonewton. So we'll take the load from each wheel of the crane girder as 212 kilonewtons. Then after that we'll consider the critical positioning of the wheels to get the maximum shear force and the maximum bending moment. Okay, so here this is the span of the gantry girder. It's of 8 meters, and then the wheelbase that can be represented as C, that is equal to 3.5 meters. Then a take moment under take moment under the wheel load 4, which is very close to the mid span. So that means here in order to get the maximum bending moment, so as I mentioned before, any one wheel of a crane girder that has to be placed at a distance of C by 4 from the center or a midpoint of the gantry girder. So the C by 4 is 0.875, so at C by 4 we need to keep this. So then whatever the bending moment we will get below this load, so that is the maximum bending moment what we can get in the gantry girder. So in order to find the maximum bending moment, first we need to determine the support reaction. Okay, so in this case, in order to find the support reaction, so first we'll find the magnitude of RC. To find the magnitude of RC, we need to take the moment of all the forces about D. So when you take the moment of all the forces about D, that is RC into 8, then which is clockwise, so it is taken as positive. Then moment produced by 212 kilonewton, that is 2 anticlockwise, so this is minus 212 into 1.375, that is this particular load, 212 into 1.375, and again 212 into 1.375 plus 1.75 plus 1.75, or directly we can take 212 into 1.375 plus 3.5, which is equal to 0. We will get the RC is equal to 165.63 kilonewton. Then the maximum bending moment will be RC into 3.125, so that will get 517.6 kilonewton. Then the factored moment will be, this needs to be multiplied by 1.5. So 517.6 into 1.5 will get 776.4 kilonewton meter. Then similarly, if we find the maximum shear force, to find the maximum shear force, the one wheel of the crane girder that has to be placed over the support. So whatever the support reaction over which you have the wheel of the crane girder, so that reaction will be the maximum shear force. So if you look into this arrangement, a wheel that has been placed over the support at C, so whatever the value RC will get, so that is the maximum shear force. So the maximum shear force will be in order to find the maximum shear force, that is RC, we need to take the moment about D. So moment produced by RC about D, it's in clockwise, so it is positive. Then moment produced by 212 about D, it's in anti-clockwise, so 212 into 8. Then moment produced by this load, 212 into 4.5. Again, that is also anti-clockwise, so this is minus. So if we work it out, this will get RC is equals to 313.25. So now we got the vertical bending moment and the shear force due to the vertical load. So now we'll see the bending moment and the shear force due to the horizontal load. So horizontal load and its moment, you know that it can be taken as a 10% of lifted weight and the trolley weight. Horizontal force is equals to a 10% of 275 by 4, and that is equal to 6.875 kilonewton, and the factored force will be 10.5, and then the moment due to the horizontal load will be 25.64 kilonewton. So now we got the magnitude of the bending moment and everything. So then we will take the a trial section. So we'll consider the trial section for the gantry girder. So from the steel table, we'll try the section ISMB 500. At 95.2 kg per meter, and then over that a channel section needs to be placed, that is ISMC 400 at 49.4 kg per meter, and then the top cover plate will be of length 320 by 20 mm thickness and bottom cover plate 320 by 40 mm thick. So the overall properties the section what we have taken, that is as follows. There is a I axis and I z, it's about 230194.5 into 10 power 4 mm to the power 4, and the total area is about 376.15, and CXX is 283.7, and RY is 9.57 centimeter, and for ISMC 400 area is 6293, CYY is 24.2, and the thickness of the web is 8.6, and for ISWB 500 area is 121.22 into 100 mm square, and So these are the overall properties of the section what we have considered. So first we need to determine the section modulus, the plastic modulus of the section what we have taken. So here in this figure the area of the shaded portion that is equal to half of the total area. So that can be determined using this relation where you will get the value of n is equal to 235.61 mm. Then the plastic modulus that can be determined using the relation A into Y. A is equal to 9.05 and Y is 106 mm³ and 106. So ZP is equal to the product of this mm³. So then after that we'll check for the after selecting the sections, then we need to check for the capacity of the sections. So whether the sections what we have considered that can resist the load what it is getting or not. So first we'll do the check for the moment resistance. Here for the laterally unsupported beam we have the relation for the design bending strength in IS 800, that is MD is equals to BB, ZP and FPD. Here we need to get the value of BB, ZP and FPD. So in order to get that value, so we need some we should know the some parameters. So E is equals to 2 × 10⁵. LLT, that is a span, is 8 meter, and the dimension of the flanges, and in order to find the FCRB we need all these parameters. So substitute all the parameters in this relation. So 1.1 pi square E divided by LLT divided by RY plus 1 plus 1 1 plus 1 by 20 LLT by RY HF by TF. So we know L is a span, RY is the radius of gyration, HF is the height of the flange, TF is the thickness of the flange. So by substituting all the values we will get FCRB. So when you get the FCRB, when you see in 13A table, which is in page number 55 of IS 800, so we can get the design bending strength or design bending stress FBD for the section what we have taken. So here we already noticed that P and beta B is a 1 for the plastic sections. So when we substitute all these values we will get the design bending strength. So here this design bending strength that needs to be greater than the bending moment what the section is getting. So if the design bending strength is more than the bending moment what the section is getting, then the section what we have taken is safe. Then we'll do the check for the shear resistance. So here first here we need to find the magnitude of the design shear strength. Then whatever the design shear strength you will get for the section, that needs to be greater than the shear force what the section is getting. So we'll find the design shear strength. So that can be found using the relation mu n by gamma m naught. So gamma m naught is 1 by 1. AV is a so here to find the design shear strength we'll find the value of AV. A is a shear area. So we know that in a I section the web portion of the section, so that that portion will resist the shear force. So we'll take the shear area has, the overall depth of the section, that multiplied by thickness of the web, because this is the area which contributes in resisting the shear force. So since h is the overall depth of the section and tw is the thickness of the web, that is 9.9, we will get av is equals to 5629.14 mm square. So vd will be equal to av into 250, that divided by root 3, that multiplied by gamma m naught. So vn is equals to av fy by root 3. So here av is 5629.14, fy is 250, and divided by root 3. This whole thing divided by gamma m naught, that will give the design shear strength. Gamma m naught is 1.1. So if we substitute here, we'll get the design shear strength as 738.63 into 10 power 3 newtons. Hence, the magnitude of the design shear strength of the section what we have taken, it is greater than the magnitude of the shear force what the section is getting. So hence, the section is safe under shear. So then we'll do the check for the web crippling. So here also, the local web crippling Fw, that has to be more than the magnitude of the shear force. So that can be determined using the local that can be determined using the relation, that is Fw B1 plus N2, that multiplied by Tw Fy divided by gamma m naught. So B1 we'll assume it as 100, and N2 already we have determined, that is 136.75 thickness of the web base 9.9, that multiplied by Fy is 250, and gamma m naught is 1.1. So when we substitute all the values, we'll get the shear force, the web capacity as 532.38 kilonewton. So this capacity is more than the shear force, and the section is safe, is also safe under web crippling. So next we look into the buckling of the web. So we know that since it is subjected to the vertical load, there is a chance of buckling of the load, buckling of the web portion also. So we need to check for the buckling strength. The buckling strength can be determined using the relation B1 plus N1 Tw into FCD. B1 is 100, and to determine the value of FCD from table 9C, we need the value of lambda, that is the ratio of KL by R. So lambda is 3.44. From table number 9C, we will get FCD as 229 newton per mm square. So the buckling strength will be equal to 100 plus H1 284.9, that multiplied by thickness of the web is 9.9, that multiplied by 227. Here the buckling strength will get 865 into 10 power 3, which is greater than the shear force what the section is getting. And again, so here since we are using a some additional section other than the I section. So we need to have determine the size of the weld to connect the plate and the channel section with the top flange. So for that it is dependent on the magnitude of the force at this junction, that is the lateral force. We know the magnitude of the lateral force, that is 8.71 Newton per meter. So if you equate it with the strength of the weld equation, so we'll get the size of the weld required for it. So minimum is 5 mm. So we'll provide a 5 mm weld throughout the length, both for the top and bottom flange, to connect the plates and a channel section. So this is how the section looks like. So I section with a plate at the top, over that a channel section has been placed. So this completes the design of the gantry girder. Thank you.